Please pray with me. We bless our holy name, O Lord, O God, for all your servants who, having finished their course, now rest from their labors. Give us grace to follow the example of their steadfastness and faithfulness, to your honor and glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Just a couple of notes about today's service. First, today is the new format for filming and worshiping digitally. We're wanting to do something just a little bit different because we put out two services. This service, but also we film and post our 11 o'clock service. That 11 o'clock service will remain the same, the very traditional service with all the exciting things that make up traditional United Methodist worship. But this service is going to be a little different, maybe a little less formal. An attempt on my part to speak directly to you at your homes as if I was sitting across the living room from you. The sermon will be different. So if you're wanting to hear a different message, you'll have that chance to hear two messages from me each week. Maybe that's too many, I don't know, but we'll see how it goes for a while. And we just want to try to keep it fresh, keep doing something different. So this is the first day with that effort. Secondly, today is All Saints Day. And All Saints Day is a very important day in the life of the Christian faith. We as Christians believe that this world, this life, is not all that exists, but that we have a life prepared for us in heaven by God. And Revelation will describe that life as a place where there is no tears or heartache or pain or sorrow or even death, for all has been overcome by and through Jesus Christ. You know, that's a wonderful reality. And I look forward to the day when I will get to meet my father's father, my grandfather, for the very first time. He died before I was born. And I look forward to seeing my mom and my dad and my grandfather and just all of these wonderful family and friends and parishioners that I've known across the span of now almost 30 years of ministry. But even more than that, we have to keep in mind that when we lose someone, when they become a part of the eternal cloud of witnesses, it still hurts. Death separates and divides us, and we miss that person. We wish that we could hear their voice or hold their hand or be in their presence one more time, and that's not yet to be, but one day will be, according to God's goodness and kindness. I've had the pleasure of serving as the pastor of this wonderful church now for about a year and a half. It's hard for me to keep that in my mind because of COVID, so I feel like I've started and stopped and started and stopped and started and stopped. But I can say that all of these persons who are on our list of honored dead are persons whose names I know and who I've had relationship with. I think of Paul Wittenberger, who the first time that I visited him as his pastor in the Pines, we were there together and he was waiting to eat his lunch, and I said, "Paul, can I pray for you before you eat lunch?" And Paul looked me straight in the eye and said, "No." And I think of, you know, Ken Lewis, and the first day that I arrived at this church as the pastor, and Ken had to meet with me, and he said, "I am your liturgist, and not only that, I am your chief liturgist until whenever." And he was, and he's missed greatly. I think of Joyce Pittman, who was one of my very, very favorite people. A sweet, kind, wonderful, wonderful woman. Edie Brennan, all of these persons, Dave Moquin, Bill Boggs, Judy's husband, and they're all special, and now that I've been here long enough, I know them as people, not simply as names, and that means that I and all of us miss them. But we miss them with hope, because one day we shall be together forever. People ask me, what is heaven like? And I'm going to be very honest, I don't know. All I do know is that at the very center of heaven is Jesus Christ. And folks, that's good enough for me. So I'm going to read to you these names of persons who in the past year died as members of this fine congregation. And I'm going to pause for just a moment. At 11 o'clock, we'll ring the bell. We'll do all these things that are part of our tradition, our practice. We've already commended them to God's care in eternity as God has cared for them through their lives. We just want to remember them one more time and say thanks be to God for this person, for all persons who are now a part of that great cloud of witnesses who touched our hearts, and for the promise that one day, by faith, we shall be there too, either through our death or through the return of Christ. So hear the names of these honored dead. Ben Wiley, Bill Boggs, Paul Wittenberger, Virginia Reister, Lois Lohmeyer, David Moquin, George Gow, Elizabeth W. Campbell, Robert Post, Gracie Bush, Elizabeth Vogelsang, Christine Hubsher, Kenneth Lewis, Betty Frankie, Carol Petschorsky, Edie Brennan, Joyce Pittman, and Gertrude Casey. We give thanks for all of these persons. And take just a moment in your mind, remember those folks who have touched your life and who are now with God. And let us pray. Eternal God, we thank you for all of these saints of God, children of God, who have run the race, who have finished the course, and for whom the prize, the crown of righteousness, is laid up in heaven. Some of them we knew. Some were family, friends, co-workers, all fellow brothers and sisters in Jesus. Some of them we didn't know, and we won't know this side of eternity, but they're your people, and that means that they're our people also. For these families who grieve, we pray. Comfort and give them peace. For anyone who grieves this day across this great world of yours, we pray also and asking that your peace might rest and abide upon them. Gracious God, for the saints of the church, for those who follow Jesus, for those who sit with us in this place, on Sunday mornings, before and after COVID-19, we give thanks. May we take seriously the reality that we are eternal beings, not just flesh and blood and here for a moment, but that we will live forever with you by faith and trust. That what we do with our lives now matters, and that how we treat one another matters even more. Gracious God, on this All Saints Day, this day when we remember those who have touched our lives, help us to always be thankful. No one person got here on their own. No one person had the faith that they have, the life that they have, without another. And so we give thanks for you, for Jesus, in all things, but for these dear ones whom we loved and whom you love eternally. This we pray in the name of our Christ, and I invite you to pray with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Please now hear 1 John 3, verses 1 to 3. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known to us. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Now that I've taken my mask off, I'm able a little bit easier to talk with you. But I do want to take just a moment and remind you how important it is to practice safety and to wear a mask here at the church, but also other places where you go. It is just really important. And as Christians, we believe that our primary concern is not ourselves. Our first concern is God, and our second concern is the well-being of others. So here at Community Church, and also wherever you might go, please be careful. Take care of yourself and your health and well-being, and wear a mask. Let us pray together. Now, O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart prove acceptable to you, my rock and my redeemer. I love that passage of scripture that Diane read because it reminds me of something that is, I believe, unique and special about God. It's this, that God sees us not as we are, but God sees us as we might become. That God is already looking at the potential we have to be faithful, to serve, to love others, and God sees that potential being realized through his loving, grace-filled, kind, gentle heart. And God knows that we're going to make mistakes along the way, right? That we're going to err. No one is perfect except for Jesus. But that we're going to get there by God's grace and kindness. In Methodism, we call that sanctification. And that's a big word meaning that we're on our way, journeying to becoming increasingly ever more like Jesus. But I say the word sanctification to you because we're reminded that today, being All Saints' Day, we're looking for people who are sanctified, who are on that journey to realizing their potential of being more like Jesus. You know, that's what I want to do and be. Every day I want to be a little more like Jesus, and a little more like Jesus, and a little more like Jesus. And I'll tell you, even as a clergy person, I fail all the time. But thanks be to God for the grace and goodness of God. It allows me to get up and to keep moving forward. Not of my own effort, but of God's grace-filled kindness. So what am I going to talk about on this All Saints Sunday? I'd like to talk to you about a variety of things, but just a few thoughts that I think are appropriate for All Saints Sunday. Who do you think is a saint? If I were to ask you to tell me, to name someone that was a saint, who would you name? If you're a Protestant, a Methodist, a Baptist, Presbyterian, you might mention the name of Billy Graham. And I can remember meeting Dr. Graham one time in my life as I was attending a Billy Graham School of Evangelism. Getting to be in the presence of a great godly man. And even though he's not been canonized by the Roman Catholic Church according to their tradition and practice, were you to say, Billy Graham, I would agree with you. One of the things I really liked about him and respected was the fact that as he looked back over his life, he knew there were areas where he had failed and needed to grow. And I think that's true of all of us. He was a humble, kind man. Others of you might say Dorothy Day, who was a member of the Catholic Workers Party in New York City and who worked in our country on the streets of New York, helping the poorest of the poor and helping persons find jobs and children to get education. And Dorothy Day, as Robert Coles of Harvard University wrote about her, is definitely in my book a saint too. Others of you would say someone like Mother Teresa. How can she not be a saint? Because she commented that when she ministered to the lowest among the population on the streets of Calcutta, in each person she saw the presence of Jesus. I mean, it's just amazing. I get so caught up in what I have to accomplish during the day and my busy routine and the tasks that I have to check off my list. And sometimes because I'm so list-oriented, I just add extra tasks that I've already done just to check them off. And Mother Teresa paused and saw in each person the presence of Jesus. And it's a whole different approach. Yeah, she certainly is a saint. Were you to ask me, I would say someone like Clarence Jordan, who has always been a hero for me, who wrote the Cotton Patch Gospels and was founder of Cornelia Farms and who promoted the fact that blacks and whites can live together because God made all people and everyone is shaped and formed in the image of God. And despite threats against his life and the life of his family, worked towards a vision and a dream that he held dear. And Clarence Jordan had a great impact on another man who would later be president, who you and I know as Jimmy Carter. If you were to ask me who saints are, I could name to you endless people who sat in the pews of churches that I have served over the years. You know, one of the funniest things about those types of saints is that they're embarrassed when you name them. You know, it's like that they're so humble they don't want to be thought of in that fashion. They're not doing it because they want someone to notice them. They're doing it because it's the right thing, the godly thing to do. My favorite saint is Saint Francis of Assisi. Now, I've been reading and studying St. Francis for probably the last 4 or 5 years, off and on as I have time here and there, and I'm not an expert on St. Francis, but I just find something in him that is very Christ-like, that's very attractive. And I love nature, I love being outdoors, I love my dogs. I think I have fed the squirrels so that I have the fattest squirrels in ocean pines and the healthiest birds. And St. Francis loved nature and loved God's creation. And you often see him pictured with a dove or two on his shoulder or perhaps in his arms. And he's there with his tonsure, his haircut. And he is, you know, emphasizing the fact that nature is God's arena of giving witness to God's presence with us. And I have a St. Francis of Assisi statue in my front yard, in my front garden. I'm probably the only Methodist there and has a saint statue of a saint in his yard. I'm sure people drive by and think that a Catholic person lives there, but I don't care because I'm reminded of St. Francis every time I leave or enter my house. St. Francis' story is told that he came to a village that was being terrorized by a wolf. That the wolf was a threatening and menacing and horrible presence, and that this wolf was terrifying to children and adults alike, and he determined that God had put him there to solve or to do something about this situation. So he met with the people of the village, and he said that after he had met with them that it was time for him to go and talk with the wolf, and he asked the wolf his name, and the wolf said Gubbio, and he talked to Gubbio, and he said, you know, you're menacing, terrifying, and horrifying, and you're scaring the children, and you're eating people, and this is not what God wants you to do, and it's got to stop. And so he asked the wolf if he was fed by the people and loved by the people rather than being stones being thrown at him or other things happening to try to kill him or scare him away, would he stop hurting the people? And Gubbio agreed. And the story is that Gubbio the wolf and the people of the village became fast friends, and the people of the village took care of him, and Gubbio protected them until he died. Is the story true? I don't know. It's just a neat story that illustrates that St. Francis was a man of peace, bringing people together rather than dividing them. And the story is told that when the Fifth Crusade was taking place, that St. Francis determined to travel with the army, and he and another of the brothers who are what we call now Franciscans left, and on their own, they walked across that divided space between the armies of the Sultan and the armies of the Crusade, and everyone thought he was trying to get himself killed, but he wanted to meet with the Sultan, and for multiple days he sat and discussed faith and life, Jesus and Muhammad with the Sultan, and bought for all of these dear people about 7 days of peace. Ultimately, though, the Crusades continued. But the Sultan said that St. Francis' example was so great that he almost converted him. Later in life, Francis receives the stigmata, which still I don't understand, and that's the markings of the sufferings and the pain of Christ in his hands and in his feet. Do I believe it's real? I believe God can do anything, and this saint had asked to share in the sufferings of Jesus, share in the passion of Christ. Someone has translated a portion of scripture or paraphrased it in a way that I think is kind of interesting when we talk about saints. They translate it in this way: you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you odd. There are a lot of people who have been odd for Christ. Odd because the world sees things differently. The world says, get all you can. Don't worry about the other guy. Do unto others before they do you in. And all other kinds of such nonsense. But the Bible says, put God first. Practice the golden rule. Live your life for eternity with godly values rather than simply the values of the society around you. And if that makes us odd, so be it. The New Testament, in talking about saints, says that a saint is anyone who follows Jesus. We might want to call them disciples or Christians or followers of the way, but Paul, in writing to the churches of the first century and the early second century, says that his letters are addressed to the saints at Ephesus or the saints at Philippi or the saints in the region of Galatia, meaning that those folks who just claim Christ as their Lord and Savior. So I want you to do me a favor. If you're in a room with other people, or a house with other people, I want you to take just a moment to look out. Don't stare, they might think you're strange, but again, that's odd, so look out. Those persons are saints. Take a moment to look at yourself. Think about your feet and your hands, your legs, and this wonderful body that God has given us. You're a saint too. This day is for you. All Saints Day. One of the things I know about God's church, we tend to make it smaller and smaller and smaller because our focus is on our local church. I love this church. This church has such tremendous people. But God's church is huge and enormous. And I can't wait until the splendor of heaven when we hear God's praises being sung in languages and in styles and in ways that just we can't even imagine in heaven. You know, a few years ago, a movie came out about a little boy who had died and he had gone on to heaven. He had seen the visions of what heaven is like. And we talk about near-death experiences. I don't need all of that stuff, and it's probably fine, but I just believe in heaven. I believe in it because the Bible tells me that there is one. And that heaven is a place where, according to John in Revelation, sickness and pain, heartache and suffering and war and violence and name-calling and racism and sexism are all done. They don't exist there. It tells me that death is over, not just for a short time, but for all eternity. That Christ is won, that evil is defeated, that God is victor. I long for that day. In Revelation chapter 21, John, who also wrote the text that Diane read earlier today that we referenced, has a little line that's like my favorite line in the Bible. Maybe not my favorite, I like a lot of them, but one of my favorites. It says this: He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And John is writing about us, about those who remain on earth now, whose eyes are filled with tears because someone we love has gone to be numbered among those saints that are in eternity, as Hebrews says, that great cloud of witnesses watching and cheering us on. And maybe your loved one is there. Just know that God loves, God cares, God understands. Know that God is caring for and loving your loved one in ways that are just awesome. And know that God cares and loves you and me. I've seen lots of books recently about who's the first five people you're going to want to meet in heaven. For me, it's still Jesus. Will always be Jesus. It'll be people that I'd like to see. I don't know whether we'll know each other. I don't know whether we'll be able to recognize each other in a way that we did this lifetime. I don't know. I'm not worried about that. I just know that it's where Jesus is. And because of that, that's where I want to go. I want to close with a little story from my family. I had wonderful parents. I was blessed to have just two outstanding parents. Mom and Dad were good to me and good to my sister Gail and in the community of Pocomoke City and just good people, and I'm proud of them. Mom died first. We have a family history of aortic aneurysms, and five of our family members have died of that horrible reality, Mom being one. And Dad remained about another 4 or 5 years, and he missed Mom greatly. So he would often turn to Gail, my sister, and I and say, you know, when I get to heaven, I want to do two things. And we would say, well, Dad, what is that? And he would say, first, I want to see Jesus. And, you know, I figure that's a given. That's going to happen because Jesus is going to be right there to welcome him home. We often talk about Peter at the pearly gates. I think it's going to be Jesus. But the second thing he said was, I want to ask your mom to marry me all over again. And Mom had said all along in life that one was enough. And we're not sure whether that happened or not, seriously or facetiously. But heaven's a place that is like no other. So for the saints of the church, for these dear people who have lived and died in faith and who are now with God, we give thanks. For the saints of the church who are normally on a Sunday morning sitting here in this room with me, I've got four other people here with me. We give thanks as they represent an entire congregation of people. For you, we give thanks also. May this All Saints Day be a day of blessing as you and I remember and give thanks for the saints of God, the Church Universal, of Community Church, and of our lives. Amen. This morning we've tolled a bell for the honored dead. On this All Saints Day, I just want to say thank you for joining us. Thank you for your financial and personal support of Community Church. May God bless you. And in all things, may we remember those who have gone before and who are among us, and even ourselves who are saints of God. Let us pray. Now may God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit bless, preserve, and keep you now and forever. Amen.